Okay, I'm going to give you guys a little bit more review. Then we're going to do praise and worship, and we're going to pray. We're going to welcome the Holy Spirit in. But here's just a recap from last week, just to get your mind postured and positioned so we can move on. The revelation gateway is a spirit that is released from heaven. We went over the verses of the seven spirits of God that is talked about in the book of Revelation. And the spirit of revelation is one of them, and the spirit of understanding. They are spirits. These are spirits these are the characteristics of the Holy Spirit that function through these spirits. These are attributes of the Holy Spirit, co-laboring with the seven spirits of God. Because the Bible says that the Holy Spirit brings you to understanding and awareness. We talked about the importance of the fear of God. Without the fear of the Lord, there's no understanding. Without the fear of the Lord, there's no knowledge. And without the fear of the Lord, there's no wisdom. That's what the Bible says. All your scriptures are in your notes. It's a domino effect. Without the fear of the Lord, then all of the other gates become plugged. It's the number one gate that has got to be open after you fall in love with Jesus, is your intentions to want what he wants, to not like what he doesn't like, and to love everyone while you're doing it. So the fear of the Lord causes the domino effect for the spirit of revelation and the spirit of understanding to now move into those gates, and any other spirit that was occupying those gates, blocking your understanding, blocking revelation, which is what happened to Erica. She couldn't get revelation. She couldn't get understanding because confusion of the mind. Those spirits have to go. They can't stay. Okay? And so an example I gave you was Peter. Jesus asked him, "Who do people say that I am? What's people saying about me?" And Peter says, "You are Jesus, the Son of the living God." And Jesus replies, "You did not come to that understanding on your own, but the Holy Spirit told you." Meaning that we don't understand this class on our own. You're not doing this class in your own strength. You're doing it in partnering and co-laboring with the Holy Spirit and the seven spirits of God. The fear of the Lord, pride and self-centeredness will reside at that gate. So we dealt with people that are self-centered and prideful, because those are the people that are under the assumption that they can do life on their own and they don't seek God for counsel. So we took care of that. And the revelation gateway, because when you get knowledge, spiritual knowledge on spiritual things, the enemy wants to attack you in the spirit and twist words of spiritual knowledge and have you yield to another area. What this means is, we went over anybody who was practicing the occult or from another faith, or Erica talked about Jehovah Witnesses, witchcraft, all of those different things. We talked about familiar spirits coming in, residing at those gates, and what they do is cause confusion. And they cause confusion as to the knowledge that you're going to receive. Okay? So we took care of that. All right, now we're going to move on. Now, before we move on, do you understand that, and do you have a question? No? Okay.
I wrote down here, you talked about Freemasons.
Yes.
Okay. Could you, I have a friend.
Yes.
I'm asking that because I have a friend that's a Mason.
We're actually going to talk about that today, but Freemason is a secret society.
I understand that.
And so it is linked to, you go all the way back to the seed.
Okay.
Not what the people are doing now, but you always go back to the seed because every seed reproduces after its own kind. So when you go back to the origin of a Freemason, it's not good. Okay? That's in the simple terms I can give you. And yeah, spiritual warfare does reside there.
Okay. Well, I'm just a little bit confused on what was that ritual? I mean, that was like demonic then that she did. In the name of God, I think.
With the nuns?
Yeah.
Well, that's what they do in that faith.
I was not Catholic, but I mean, not that there's, I mean, but I'm just saying I was working there.
So right.
But I'm blaming.
You're basically talking to dead people when you do that. Yeah. So. Okay, one last thing and then we're going to move on. We have these Christmas boxes. I did not explain these effectively last week, but what this is inside this box is this little paper, and it tells you how to fill it, what to put in it on the back of the paper, various crayons, pencils, sharpeners, marker, whatever, one big aha gift, and then a bunch of little things, and you scan the barcode and pay for it. It's $9, and it goes to third world, $10, and it goes to third world countries. And so when you do this, they also, if I think you pay extra for this, I forget how much more. I think it's $5, but I'm not sure. But they will receive a Bible and a workbook in their native language, along with the shoebox that you send. And so if you go on their website and look at the difference that they're making in the world, it's incredible. Many churches have been built because they have the Bible in their hands. And it's a really great ministry. We've been part of it for several years. So the boxes are up here if you want to be part of it too. Ascension Day marks the moment that Jesus ascended into heaven before his disciples. That's why you are in ascension class, okay? You're going into higher places, higher frequencies, okay? It marks the moment Jesus ascended into heaven at the Mount of Olives, this bringing man into the fullness of God. Your spirit, because of the Holy Spirit, your spirit has now joined with God's spirit, made brand new, and now you're able to function and co-labor with him and carry out the tasks that he gives you. We are discussing the spirit within a man. The spirit within a man. I said earlier you're a spiritual being. That's so hard to understand for people because your visual that you see is the fact that you're flesh. But you're a spiritual being with flesh on it. And if you can bring yourself to that conclusion and to that understanding, you'll have a better understanding of what you're dealing with when you pray and in the spiritual realm. Since you are a spirit that has a body and a soul, the spirit is in the spirit dimension at all times. What does this mean? Now, this is heavy, so I don't want to lose you. Your spirit is in a spirit dimension at all times. So when you have faith that can move mountains, this is in the spirit. When you have hope, it's in the spirit. When you worship, something takes place in the spirit. When you have fear of the Lord, there's activity in the spirit. Look what all happened last week because we were aware of the spiritual realm and the authority that you carry to tell the devil, no, this is not my portion. Dreams and visions take place in these dimensions. We're always in the spiritual realm, moving and interacting all the time. You just can't see it. If you read in the Bible, I think it was with Elijah, with the horse and the chariots, and there was a war in front of him, and the people he was with was scared, and he said, open up his eyes, God, so he can see. And when he opened up his eyes, then he saw the spiritual realm of God's army. But in the physical, he saw the army of man. And once he saw God's army, all bets were off. And so that's what we're learning. Okay? That's what we're learning. We're in the spirit. And we're going to work our way to the soul and the dimensions that are in your soul. Whatever controls the gateways in your lives, who or what has access to them? So whatever controls your life in these gateways will exercise authority. So they no longer do with these testimonies. They are rid of their authority. They're gone for good. They cannot come back. It's a done deal. Whom the Son sets free is free indeed. Hallelujah. I'm reading to you a lot of information before we get to worship. Normally we start off with music, but because we're going to be camping at the worship gateway, okay, I have a little bit of a system here tonight. So we're going to do a little talking before you start to worship with all your heart and all your soul and all your strength. I'm going to give you some new knowledge now. This is an interesting scripture in the book of Ecclesiastes. Ecclesiastes 12, 6 through 7 says, remember him before the silver cord is severed and the golden bowl is broken. I'm going to explain this to you. Before the pitcher is shattered at the spring and the wheel broken at the well, and the dust returns to the ground it came from, and the spirit returns to God who gave it. I'm not going to interpret everything in between for the sake of time, but what I want you to see is the silver cord is severed upon the death of a person. The silver cord is much like the umbilical cord when a woman gives birth to a baby. The umbilical cord is visible, connecting the unborn child to the mother for the purpose of food and oxygen. The umbilical cord is a conduit between developing the fetus and the placenta. Without it, the child wouldn't survive. So is this connection in the spirit of God with the silver cord. Without the silver cord, you would not be a human being active here on earth. So in the spiritual realm, there is what is called a spirit cord. It's a silver cord that you are literally attached to God. The Bible says you're made in his image. Everybody has a knowing of God, and it's because of the spiritual cord. Now, knowing that you have a spiritual cord with the Father, God is training you while you're in this class. And what comes to my mind is a book that I read called Training from Both Sides of the Leash. I trained my dog to be a therapy dog for 1 year. And during this year, I tethered my dog to my belt on my pants. All year long, this dog was part of me, so that I could help create the behaviors in the dog and correct bad ones, But she was with me all the time, connected to me. I tethered her. You in this class are tethering yourself to God emotionally and spiritually through being in these gates, through being in the worship, through spending time in prayer. There is a tethering that is taking place. There is a silver cord. How awesome is that? Amen. That in the spiritual realm, that actually exists. So I wanted to give you a prophetic picture. If you're listening to this and you're thinking, this is too much, I really don't get it, put it on a shelf, okay? Because we have a mixture of people in this class. Some need milk and some need meat. Eventually, one has to go from breastfeeding to eating solid food. Amen? Amen. And so we're trying to balance this class the best that we can, but don't get discouraged if you don't get it. Just say, well, that's weird. Put it on a shelf. We're moving on to the next best thing. Matthew 26:41, it says, watch and pray that ye enter not into temptation. The spirit indeed is willing, but the flesh is weak. What's that mean? Your spirit man is willing to do everything around the spirit, but the flesh, which is your emotions, your choices, your intentions, your conscience, your imagination, your mind is weak. The Bible says your soul is at enmity with God. It means that it wants to separate from God. But your spirit, who has the silver cord, wants to do these things. Have you ever been in that place where, oh my, I want to pray, but then you think of every excuse, I'm tired, I had a long day. Suddenly, you know, you're itching, your nose is bothering you. I mean, everything that you can think of gets thrown at you. You become irritated, okay? Because the soul doesn't want to do it, but your spirit, your Holy Spirit, is craving to do it. Jesus says this in Matthew 26:41. He said, watch and pray. Watch. Watch for what? Watch. Watch because the enemy roars and prowls like a lion. He says, watch and pray. Then he says, that ye not enter into temptation. Jeff did a great video the other day. I posted it on Oasis, all about praying and temptation. It's a really good video. But prayer and time spent in these gates when they're clean, okay, ward off temptation. Because the Bible says when you resist the devil, he has to flee. This causes resistance. He ain't going to want to come to you when your gates are all flowing, okay, because he knows it's territory that he is not going to be able to claim. Eventually, he has to back off, okay? Jesus was getting ready to go to the cross. He was literally sweating blood. And his disciples were falling asleep. Now think of this. He said, please watch and pray for me. He was getting ready to die. This brutal death, they knew about it. He told them. And they fell asleep. If your best friend was with you and was going to the cross for you, and he said, watch and pray, would you sleep through it? Imagine the warfare that was going on over these disciples. They were tired, they were exhausted emotionally, physically, traveling, listening to what was going to happen to Jesus. He's going to die, they're going to lose their Savior. They didn't understand of the concept that he was going to raise again and free the world. Okay, so know that the battle is real. It was real to the disciples. Okay, so it's going to be real to you. Your verse that you are to memorize, 1 Thessalonians 5:23, say it with me. May the God of peace sanctify you through and through. May your whole spirit, soul, and body be kept blameless at the coming of Christ. This is your theme scripture for your class, that God asks that your whole spirit and soul and body be kept blameless, which means after you get baptized, there's a little bit of work that's to be done on our part and surrendering to the Lord, watching and praying, and making activity happen in all of the gates that are up there. 2 Timothy 3:16. All scripture is, come on, God breathed and is useful for teaching, rebuking, correcting, and training in righteousness. Young Timothy's telling the church why we have the Bible. To teach you, to rebuke you, and to correct you. It's not a bunch of fluffy flowers and a big, you know, there's a lot in there. The second part of that is so that the servant of God may be thoroughly equipped for every good work. So all scripture is God breathed so that you can be thoroughly equipped for every good work. So we're going to enter into the worship gateway, and I'm going to read you Psalms 103, 1 through 5. And David says, praise the Lord, my soul. All my inmost being, praise his holy name. Listen to what David is saying here. He's telling his spirit, he's telling his soul, praise the Lord, my soul. Then he says, all my inmost being, praise his holy name. He's telling his soul what to do. Much like when you struggle with coming into the place of surrender and prayer and worship, you have to tell your soul what to do. One thing Merle taught me at our meetings, he would say, I command my soul to submit to the Holy Spirit. Okay, so tell your soul what to do. It's not supposed to run you. Your spirit is supposed to run you, not the soul. Remember, your soul's not connected in the silver cord. Your spirit is. So David says, praise the Lord, my soul, all my inmost being, praise his holy name. Then he said it again, praise the Lord, my soul, and forget not all his benefits. Now he commands his soul to remember the benefits as being an heir of Christ, which means deliverance, healing, freedom. Because your soul is going to tell you a month from now, you're not really free. Or what you went through wasn't really real. But now you have to tell your soul to be quiet and submit to the Holy Spirit. Because it is written in my Bible, it is written that by his stripes I am healed. It is written. If it is written, therefore, it comes forth. God is not a God that he shall ever lie to us. It is written. He said, who forgives all your sins and heals all your diseases. This is David, telling his soul, who forgives all your sins and heals all your diseases, who redeems your life from the pit and crowns you with love and compassion, who satisfies your desires with good things so that your youth is renewed like an eagle. This is a mighty psalm where David is telling his soul to remember that we have a God that heals diseases, redeems life from the pit, a God that loves you, a God of compassion, a God that wants to satisfy you with good things. There are religious spirits that don't want to hear that at all because they think you're supposed to be in a poverty or poor to really be a follower of Christ. There are people that really believe that. But he says that satisfy you with good things so that your youth is renewed like the eagles. Bless the Lord, O my soul. Amen. He commands his soul to praise God. We're going to get up, we're going to sing, we're going to do praise and worship, and we're going to command our soul to worship the Lord, to worship him as he would like to see, to worship him through your heart, and through your spirit, like you mean it. Like if he was standing right in this room, how would you worship your Lord? Because he's here. He's here. Father God, we welcome you into this class, Lord. I thank you for your holiness. I thank you for your freedom. I thank you for what you're about to do. I thank you, Lord, that you are a God of 100%. Holy Spirit, you are welcome here. I ask you, Holy Spirit, to come. Lord, I can't do this class without you. I won't do this class without you. I ask you, Lord, to be my microphone, to be my vocal cords. I give full submission of my mind and my heart to the Lord right now. I ask you, Holy Spirit, to take over it and complete surrender. I ask you, Holy Spirit, to invade this space, everybody's personal space right now in Jesus' name. I ask you, Holy Spirit, for alertness, awareness, and a quickening in their soul. I command a spirit of slumber to be gone now in Jesus' name.